called PhoneGap. How many of you have used PhoneGap already? Cool. One, two, three. So, you're very welcome to give your experience as well. Okay? I'm very not advanced programmer in PhoneGap, but have some experiences. I want to share with you today. So, PhoneGap, what is PhoneGap? Basically, I'm going to talk about first steps. What's PhoneGap? Why PhoneGap? PhoneGap is an Apache programmer. And some development structures of PhoneGap. What is PhoneGap? It's first of an open source framework specialized for mobile development. Which means, in another way, it enables people to build some kind of applications based on HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. But, assuming I have like a project I want to develop and I don't know how to use Java, I don't know how to use C++, I don't know how to use everything, PhoneGap gives you that possibility to use your skill as a web developer to deploy your application on a mobile device and use it easily. So it's been developed by Adobe Software and IBM at the beginning, and in 2011 was bought by Adobe. Why we should use PhoneGap basically? Using PhoneGap have certain advantages. I have a project. I want to develop a game, a simple application that I want to use on my Android phone. The problem is I want it to have as well as on iPhone and on BlackBerry. So and on Windows as well. Then how can I make it alone? It's impossible. I need a team for payroll. I need to set up a team, I need money. I don't have that money. So the advantage of PhoneGap is very easy. I can program HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. That's good. I just have to program web application. Then PhoneGap is like a wrapper to like a small package in which I put my application, and then I can deploy it to any kind of device I want. Android, iPhone, BlackBerry, Windows, WebOS, and so on. This is the main advantage of PhoneGap. It started in 2011, something like that, and they have now up to more than 400,000 developers worldwide using it. Beyond that, they have a kind of cloud system that they are calling PhoneGap Build, which enables people to develop without using any kind of SDK and stuff like that. You write your web application, to the PhoneGap Build, and they bring you back the kind of output you have, either you want for Android, iPhone, or whatever it is. How is PhoneGap Build basically? This is the way PhoneGap Build looks like. It means I have my web application, HTML5, CSS, and JavaScript. Then I deploy to the cloud, PhoneGap Build, and I get some output that I can run any kind of market I want. It means PhoneGap supports iPhone, Android, Bada, WebOS, BlackBerry, Windows, the eSIM, but I don't know it. Simple? No. I think it's one of the last features they add to it, definitely.
Symbian?
No, I think Symbian, Symbian is different. I know they support Symbian as well. But since Symbian is not about that, operating nowadays, I don't know. Because this is the last image from their website, basically. Another aspect of the whole thing is PhoneGap and Apache Cordova. Some people know much about Apache Cordova, some people know PhoneGap. But at the end of the day, they are the same thing. The issue is that in October 2011, PhoneGap was donated to Apache Software Foundation under the name Apache Cordova. The idea was that to maintain PhoneGap as open source. Why? A lot of developers are more interested in open source, like Android, stuff like that. And to make it easier for people to access it, then they want it to be like, okay, let's make it free for people so that you have more developers who can use it. If you make it closed, it will be hard for people to get interested into it. Because more developers are interested in developing native apps than focusing on in-built application, basically. And Now it's available under the version 2.0 for Apache license. And so at the end of the day, Apache Cordova is nothing different than a platform for building native mobile application using HTML, CSS, JavaScript. I don't know if somebody was having this kind of misunderstanding before between Apache Cordova and PhoneGap.
I think with PhoneGap, they will be also adding new services like PhoneGap Build is a part of PhoneGap rather than being part of Cordova. So similarly, Adobe will add some commercial services on top of PhoneGap.
Okay.
But they can't do that with Apache Cordova, being that an open source project. So that's the difference. So they are using the base, both are using the same source, but they can add on multiple services, commercial services, like PhoneGap Build.
Okay. Thank you. So, the most important discussion that used to go on in the internet is like, if you want to develop an application, should I develop in hybrid, should I develop in native, and so on. But the first thing is, if I don't know Java, also I'll forget Android. If I don't know Objective-C, I'll forget iPhone. But then I still want to develop an application. So, some people say now they are economy struggling with native applications. I met a guy who told me, why do you use PhoneGap? What's so nice in PhoneGap? Come and develop Java application and use Android, it's more interesting. I said, go, makes sense. That was said, now I thought it was example. Some people like that. I don't have money, as I said at the beginning. And I don't have teams, I don't have people that can code for me and stuff like that. I want my application to be on iPhone, and on the App Store, I want it to be on Play, I want it to be on BlackBerry. So the best way to go is to develop the hybrid in a way that I can bring it there if I can use it. The difference between both things is that first of all, the skills of programming, hybrid application in HTML, JavaScript, CSS, native application in like Objective-C, Java, C++, cross-platform level. Hybrid applications are cross-platform. Natives, no. Which means if I develop an application pure Java for Android, I need to find another team to develop it as well for iPhone. Diverse APIs. More specific. PhoneGap pathway is strong APIs that helps you to target some core features of your devices. I'll come back to that later. Native apps. We don't talk about the distributions, of course. If I'm an hybrid application, I can distribute it on app stores as well as a native application. That's not the problem. Updating the application, for example. If I'm updating my, let's say, my Android application, I need to submit it to Play, then you need to say accept it or validate it, and then it's like the same for an iPhone application. You need to submit to App Store. They have to work with something like that, and then they publish it for you. In hybrid application, the advantage is this one. Either some of my code, I copy my own server, that I'm not obliged definitely to submit the whole application to App Store, wait for like 1 week before they validate it for me. There are some kind of update I can make instantly on my server that can be applied to the whole application as well. Because first of all, is a web application that I'm running. It means based on my certain server. The most important part of it is the performance. Some people will tell you, no, hybrid applications are really slow. Some people will tell you, yeah, native application, of course, they are faster. But then, depending on your skill of programming, you can make an hybrid application very fast. And I'll try to show that very soon. It depends on the way you structure the whole code, the kind of architecture you're using for programming helps you to make your application a bit faster than the normal way you should have your application. Can I go? So, this is a typical web application or sitemap, for example. How many people have here kind of web application already, or program kind of website? That's good. So if it's this kind of setup for a big website or kind of web application, so I have a link that leads to the other corner and the whole structure basically, which is really good. If you can put that, just perfect, awesome. But then the problem is, I want that to be a native application running on my phone. is where the tricks come in. By using photograph. The thing is, when you use this kind of development style, the browser is responsible for the page validation. So if I want to change the page transitions, it's been triggered by the browser. If I want a new page, of course, I have like maybe JSP or PHP script. We can do some nice HTML and some CSS and it's very beautiful. And I have a website, web application that's smooth running. And then on the mobile device, it will be really laggy, it will be slow. Because if you use mobile application, you want it to be fast. If I click it once, okay, something new should come. So that's why the main core of the phone gap development strategy comes in. Quick means, you use this one. One page. If you develop for application to be hybrid, you don't need to develop like, I don't know, different kind of script, that different, different kind of pages. You have one page. And don't forget, we are using three components, HTML, CSS, JavaScript. Some point in my code, I have like HTML, blah, 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 and my apps, .js. That's the whole system that I need. Because I want one page, and the JavaScript is take care of the changing of the content. I want them that I can, with my the view and the control, I can take care of, okay, if I want this part of application to be shown, remove it from the zone, bring the other one inside. It is the core part of the whole system of hybrid application development. Because if you develop this one, as I showed you at the beginning, this one, of course, if I want to go to user, I click it, it will load a new page for me. If I want to go to, I don't know, submit, it will load another form for me. It will be taking long and long and long and long. But if you use one page, you have something really small, short, but then the script that you have behind it, and the way you code your JavaScript will make it faster. I can show a small code example. So this is basically a kind of front up application, and this is index.html. That's the whole thing. Which means with this index, I have a lot of scripts that I put in. And with those scripts and the CSS stuff, I trigger them from this part of my code. Which means in the backend, I have a lot of JavaScript code, not that big, but pretty thin, pretty small, but efficient. Which makes the application faster, and I can take care of the page transition and stuff like that.
Yes, go back to.
So here you can see some comparison about it. If you have like multi-page app and single page, the number of page, of course, is different.
Yeah.
Many pages for the normal web application that I have for my browser, and one page for the mobile devices. The user interface generation tier, which is very important. On the normal web application or browser, we generate it from the server. On the mobile application, it has to be on the client. The client takes care of generating the user interface. The language that I need, okay, Java, PHP, .NET, Ruby, blah, 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 Python, all of them. Only in JavaScript. Offline support is limited for some normal web application on the browser. And the internet, if I don't have internet, some page might not load and stuff like that. On a single page, it's an application, it's on a mobile device. It means I can use it even offline. The page transition is really interesting. The browser takes care of it in the normal web application. On a mobile device, the developer takes care of it. That's what I'm saying at the beginning. For your application to be fast, depend on the skill of programming. Yeah?
This offline support is a little bit iffy, I must say, because you might have all the JavaScript downloaded, you might have your single HTML downloaded on your phone, phone's cache. Not even talking about web cache. But,
mm-hmm.
So, but still, it has to talk to your intermediate server in terms of getting data, real-time data, or something, a list of latest news items or whatever. It's still not going to be real offline.
Okay, good. There you are right. I agree with you. But then there's some part of your actual construction as well. If I have an application on my mobile phone, and all applications need different internet connection to work.
That's true.
That's what I mean with.
Okay.
Of course, there are some applications, like if I had to submit some form stuff, I need internet connection.
Right.
Which means the offline access is, can be limited. But then compared to normal browser stuff, it's different.
Right.
And the point here is that when you talk about offline access, it's about like you're writing a block. You post that block to a local storage. And the, when the connection comes, it, the application automatically writes that to server.
Yeah.
So for you, it's seamless.
Okay.
So. Because without network, how can it drive? It needs internet.
No, that's true. So
yeah.
It's limited.
Yeah, because that's offline.
Right.
So offline can't have network.
So the performance definitely is laggy. And on a single page, it's fast. It's only for one page. I'm just removing something from the door and doing another stuff inside and don't know how to click and stuff like that. And it's been triggered to come from my JavaScript code and it's fast. I don't need a lot of time to code it. And the app asset loaded many times for the normal web application, each page with its own script and stuff like that. And a single page can load one time, it's there, just removes things from the DOM and brings them back. Is it? Good. This is something very interesting. Templates. This is a nice code app, you know, really beautiful. And you have like, I don't know, GIF tag, and then put some image in. First name, blah, blah, blah. Which is quite good in normal web development, okay? But then if you develop like that for a phone card or a hybrid application you want on your devices, the thing is that first of all, it's not easy to do it, and it's not easy to be understood as well, what you're doing. So structuring the whole system will help you later on for if you want to extend the application. So this is the best way to go, right, for example. Which means on those college brackets, I have some stuff that I can even anytime change, upload an image, I put the first name, the last name. I have a kind of template fixed that I can be called with my JavaScript and put into the DOM and then remove the data. Instead of what I have here, like normal web development, and you have lead tags and a lot of things, concatenate a lot of stuff and so on, with a lot of class and stuff like that. The best way. It's a matter of taste at the end of the day how you want to code the application. But if you come to best practice to make it, this is the best way to go. It's clear for yourself what you're doing. Any kind of person come to assist the code or check it if you can tell, okay, this is nice, better than this one on the previous page. Good. So here you can see some kind of the benefits and the advantages of using single page architecture and the templates. Of course, it's fast, it can work offline, you have the control over your experience. The downside of it is that it's a bit complex. As I'm saying, you only have one page that needs to be removed from the DOM and bring it back to your JavaScript code. So that's where the complexity comes in. You need some memory management as well. And you need some modular strategy. You need to know how to, which kind of strategy to code the whole application at the end of the day. Templates using is good. For the maintenance, it's two level and separation of concern at the end of the day. And there's some example of template you can use in JavaScript, right? Mustache, handlebars, underscores. I mean, there are a lot of templates out there you can use basically from to develop applications. And it's a matter of choice, as I'm saying it. And you might prefer using underscores, and you prefer using underscore and so on. So I can only start with them. Good. Another aspect of the architecture is the MVC, or MV whatever, you know. There's now different kind of it, definitely. Some people will swear by MVC no matter what happened. Some people will say something different. But then, bringing in this separation of concern in your development helps you to have a full control over the application you're developing. And of course, use frameworks. Because I don't see why I should go and start coding everything from scratch if there's already a very good framework out there that I can use. For time saving, money saving, and to be productive, it's good to use frameworks. And there are a lot of frameworks basically we can use. We have Sansha, jQuery Mobile, Dojo Toolkit, Backbone.js, Angular.js, Zepto, and so on. Another point of development is the abstract device features, which is a bit interesting. I've concerned myself about the interaction. What does it mean? If I have my laptop, I have a website. Of course, in JavaScript, we have some kind of click event and click it and trigger something. It's beautiful. Since it's a web application that I've developed with browser, and I put it into this kind of wrapper that is phone gap and portrait it to the cloud or to the device that I'm using, I will leave this kind of click event inside. Right, it's good. But then the difference between them is that the performance, a click event takes up to 300 milliseconds. Because if you click once, it will be waiting for it for whether you are going to make double click or not. So it takes up to 300 milliseconds before reacting. If you use kind of touch event or the touch, you only have 3 milliseconds. Which means if a user has to use your application like 3 hours a day, admitting how many times you're going to be touching the phone and calculating all these 300 milliseconds end of the day, you'll be the phone, the performance can be lagging 100 times. If I compare 3 milliseconds to 300 milliseconds, it's a lot of difference between both of them. But then, there are some good features. It means I can use click event everywhere I want, and then I use some frameworks that can help you if it target the devices. One on the laptop, okay, and leave the click event. If it is on mobile device, then change the click event to that event. It make it so you don't need to concentrate too much on whether I should use click event or not. The notifications. Of course, you have JavaScript and the natives. The problem with notifications while developing applications is that people used to target the devices instead of targeting the features. I explained it. I have a Samsung Galaxy Note 2. And if you develop it and you type Galaxy Note 2, I think it's a 1 month ago to have the Galaxy Note 3. If you have to check again my code and type the Galaxy Note 3. Instead of doing that, I prefer using like targeting the features. Does my phone have a sensor? Then I target the sensor. Then the phone, the device itself has its own functionality to trigger it for me. Which might make much more sense in developing web applications. Mm-hmm. The storage, okay, for a web application you have it online, the touch you have it offline. The sensor, as I'm saying it, you can take whether it's not available on a laptop, basically, on normal web application, but it's available on a mobile device. Another part of the architecture is the performance. When you're developing web application, you need to think more about the performance of it because the faster it is, the better it is for the user. There are some applications like, I don't know how many people have the new Quando. It's a bit slow. I don't know if it's on my own experience.
Not a bit.
Yeah. They seem like the new Bancostia. If you have it, you log in, is then I'm like, okay, let me check my content. So after, I'm not saying that they are not good developers. No, let's say the user doesn't care how good you are as a developer. You want something to be fast and usable. So though I know the system behind it, basically, as long as I have to click it and wait and say, okay, it's going to come today. And the bottleneck of it is if you have a really bad internet connection at that moment, forget it. It means thinking performance for developing application is really good. So those are things one to focus on. The user interface should not be direct on the server, but on the client side. Data to be displayed, not to be displayed from the user interface. Caching everything, basically. It makes sense. Use hardware accelerations. avoid click events, like I said before, 2 milliseconds, 300 milliseconds, and the other stuff like that. Use CSS spreadsheet, limit shadow and gradient. If you're not developing a game application, don't use a lot of shadow and stuff like that, a lot of graphics in it. That makes sense. Yeah. Avoid view flaws and testing. And one most important thing, the frameworks. People go and use jQuery Mobile because why it has cool features and stuff like that. But then, it's big. You only need maybe something that, maybe page transition. You don't need the whole thing on jQuery Mobile. So instead of using the whole stuff and to make the application heavy, maybe not on the browser, but on the mobile, just make it heavy. So look for the real framework that you need. You really need it? If you need it, then use it. If you don't need it, go and look for the specific one that you need. It makes your application light, easy to use, and faster. And of course, it will increase the performance of that application. So, small summary of what I've said. I think I've taken the whole time. Okay, that's in 5 minutes. Single page application development, use templates, MVC architecture, consider using the frameworks, abstract diverse features, and think in performance. I don't have enough time, but there are some more aspects of the architecture as well, like abstract data access, keep application browser runnable, implementing routine, I'll talk about this one very shortly, and add HTML-ish behaviors like sometimes if you're on a browser, you see something can come like JavaScript alert, something like that. You don't bring that on mobile device. So you need to think about it as well for developing application, whether you're going to use it on the browser, and if you are deploying it to the mobile device, there are certain things you need to remove out of your code definitely. Question? Yeah, please.
I've got two questions. First, do you know, was there a change with iOS 7 in the behavior of apps when the user just hits the button, so the app goes down and to the menu? Does the app receive this event now, or?
Well, I'm not sure because I'm not anyone use iPhone, not any kind of Apple product.
Okay.
So I might be the only person to give that answer. I don't know if you build something the agent that can provide an answer for him. Like
you already got the message in iOS 6. The application will go into background message.
Yeah, but you couldn't save or do anything useful there. So when you're within,
but you only had a very limited time. You get a bit more.
And that wasn't guaranteed.
You can now request additional time.
Okay.
To a couple of seconds.
Did you try that?
I don't use it, but you can request additional time. Depending on what you want to do, if it's downloading something in the background, you can actually hit minutes. If you're doing something just to save or quickly process something, you get a couple of seconds.
Okay, that's awesome. And second question would be, what are your, could you give us an idea when to use, or can you come up with examples on when you would not use PhoneGap?
Good. Why should you use PhoneGap, isn't it? If you want something that should be native, which means pure Android development, pure iOS development, go native. Don't come to PhoneGap. PhoneGap helps you, like, maybe I don't know how to develop an Objective-C, but then I want my application to be on iPhone. I'll use PhoneGap. So that I can only develop something in HTML, CSS, and JavaScript without even caring about any kind of programming language as such, and then develop it, deploy it to the market. So that's the main idea. PhoneGap is just like, as I said at the beginning, it's a wrapper. It's something like, it's a package. You put your web application inside, and then it compiles things, and then you pick it out, of it. If you want to put it on Android, or I don't know, for iPhone and stuff like that. But then, if you think you are good enough to develop it, Android native application is the best way, I'll tell you. Look for because you have more features and have more room to improve your application. But then the downside of it is that if you want to use the same application for iOS, you need another team or you need to sit again to recode the whole thing from zero and start using Objective-C to make it usable on iOS, definitely. So, if you're single programmer wants to use it on a different platform, then phone gap is a good issue, good alternative. But then if you are good enough, I'm not that good, okay? So people, I know that people are good, so you can go on a different kind of device. You can go on scratch, from start program your whole application in native style. Okay, so this is a short, the source code I've shown here. Basically, the whole structure, page slider, assumption for the framework. This is a page slider framework, about 66 lines. So I don't need the whole jQuery mobile for I don't know how many lines and before to get my stuff. And yeah, I can show you something short. I've employed directory, so let's say I'm A, B, okay, nobody. If A, B, so I have A with James King. If I click on James King, no. okay, sorry, I'm using the wrong internet connection. Okay, so now let's go. So let's say I have something like, I want to find the employee in this directory. I have A, and I have like James King and stuff like that. So if I click on James King, it shows me something like that. And from James King, I click on report. It shows me something like that. Before I was talking about the routing, says just like the router basically dispatching the kind of stuff I have in the system getting from the DOM. If you look at the URL very well, you have from directory, backbone, top code, require, slash, employees, slash one, slash report. And if you look at the URL, it never changed from the beginning to that slash, because I'm using one page. So if I want to remove something from the DOM, like, I can go to employee number three, it comes there. I can go back. Back, then I'm back, I'm at the beginning again, I click on it, and I get it again. It means I'm using one single page, one single HTML code, rather than removing from the DOM and bring something in. The whole structure is based on the JavaScript I have in the backend. So that is basically my presentation about Ebit application with PhoneGap. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much.